Are these two situations equivalent? On the left, you're sitting on the Earth. On the right, you're inside an accelerating rocket. Either way, you feel your body pushing against the floor, as if there's gravity. It's impossible for you to tell the difference. Or is it? Hey, crazies. What we're talking about here is something called the equivalence principle. If you're accelerating uniformly, any measurements you take will be physically equivalent to measurements taken in a uniform gravitational field of appropriate strength. It's one of the founding principles of general relativity. But is it true? And if it's not, does that make relativity invalid? We'll come back to both of these questions a little later. For now, I just want you to imagine you've woken up locked in a room. This room has no windows. You hear no sound. You don't feel any vibrations. You're completely isolated from the world outside. This is exactly the situation I've put one of my expendable clones in. Great, here we go again. This is gonna be hilarious. Where do you think you are, man? Well, I can't tell exactly, but I feel my weight against the floor, so I'm gonna guess this room is somewhere on Earth? Interesting. What if I told you you weren't on Earth? Oh, so I'm on another planet with the same gravity. Nope, you're inside a rocket, accelerating at exactly 9.8 meters per second squared. Weird, I can't tell the difference. That's exactly the point. The 9.8 meters per second squared is what we call the acceleration due to gravity, on Earth at least. It's a gain of 9.8 meters per second for every second of travel. For some perspective, 9.8 meters per second is about 22 miles per hour, or 35 kilometers per hour. Without air resistance, that's how much a falling object speeds up every second. For expendable clone to feel his weight against the floor, his rocket must share that acceleration. It's accelerating through deep space at the same rate that things fall toward Earth. What most of us call weight is just the feeling of weight, not the weight itself. Right now, you're feeling an upward push from the ground, or your chair, or both. You also have a weight pulling you down, something you never feel. Sure, that upward push only exists because the Earth is already pulling you down with gravity. But what if there was another reason for that upward push? Like a rocket you happen to be inside, accelerating forward. You would feel a weight, even though you don't have one. But just because one situation is indistinguishable from another, that doesn't necessarily make them equivalent. There may be an upward push in both situations, but only one has a weight, right? We're not saying his contact with the floor is gravity, are we? The equivalence principle seems to say so, but that's kind of sus. And a huge part of science is tearing ideas to shreds for the benefit of all humankind. Whatever survives is the truth, or at least approximately the truth. So let's see if we can find an exception to this rule. What if we bring in another object, say a squirrel? From the comfort of our space station, we see a squirrel floating stationary in space. As the rocket accelerates upward, the squirrel slips through a hole and into the rocket. From expendable clone's point of view, it would be as if a squirrel fell from the sky into his room. It's a perfectly reasonable conclusion. Not only does the squirrel fall, but it falls in exactly the same way that it would if it were falling on Earth. It's as if there's a gravity acting on the squirrel, even though we know there's no source of gravity nearby. The equivalence principle still seems to hold up. What if we have the squirrel come in from the side instead? Let's say the squirrel is moving in a straight line sideways. As the rocket accelerates upward, the squirrel slips through a hole in the side of the rocket. Expendable clone will see the squirrel enter his room from the wall and then fall to the floor in an arc, as if there was gravity. If we could see inside his room, we'd see the squirrel still moving in a straight line. It would be the floor accelerating upward. But according to my clone, it's the squirrel that accelerates downward like a projectile. To him, it looks like there's gravity. The equivalence principle still holds. I think it's time for something a little more extreme. Let's say his rocket is like 20 miles long and he's running up the stairs. Every 10 floors or so, he stops to measure his weight with a bathroom scale. No matter what floor he's on, his weight will always be the same. That wouldn't be true with a 20 mile tall building. In that case, your weight would gradually decrease as you went up floors. Your weight on the top floor would be 1% less than your weight on the bottom floor. Bingo bango, equivalence principle broken.
Wait a minute, that's not a uniform gravitational field.
Ah, crap! This principle does require that gravity be uniform. And that's only approximately true near the surface of the Earth. If you get far enough away, we stop being able to make that approximation. Not only does gravity get weaker with distance, it can also turn. Down is toward the center of the Earth, which isn't always the same direction. Earth is round, and sometimes we have to account for that. Really long bridges are a good example. If we were to drop two squirrels a mile apart and from a mile high, they'd be 1.3 feet or 40 centimeters closer together by the time they hit the ground. Which is yet another situation where the equivalence principle does not apply. If the accelerating rocket was a 1 mile cube, the two squirrels would stay exactly 1 mile apart the entire fall. The equivalence principle only compares uniform acceleration with uniform gravitational fields. But it was never meant to be a universal law. Its purpose is to help us design thought experiments so we can ask the right questions. The experiments in this video seem to suggest that gravity is simply acceleration we can't see. Since they only happen in our minds, they can't tell us if that conclusion is true. But if it is true, it can tell us what consequences we might see. Remember when we had a squirrel enter Expendable Clone's room through a wall? Well, what would happen if a pulse of light entered the room instead? It would also bend toward the floor like the squirrel's path did, just not nearly as much. The bend would be subtle because light is fast. Fast! If we believe the equivalence principle, and we haven't found any reason not to, then that means light should be affected by gravity, just like squirrels. Which seems absolutely bonkers. There's a reason people didn't believe Einstein and Hilbert when they published this in 1950. They had to actually prove it, which means they had to wait for a total solar eclipse. And for World War I to end. Europe was leading science at the time, and they were understandably kind of a mess. Anyway, the idea is that if light from a star passes close enough to the sun on its way to Earth, then the sun will bend its path, making it appear in a slightly different location in the sky. And I mean slightly. They estimated the deflection angle to be less than 2 arc seconds. That's less than 1/1800th of a degree. The US tried to do the experiment in June of 1918 in Baker City, Oregon. That was near the end of the war. But alas, it was cloudy with a 100% chance of failure. The next total solar eclipse wouldn't happen until May of 1919. European scientists planned out 2 expeditions. One for Sobral, Brazil, in South America, and the other for Principe in Africa. The hope was that at least one of them would get decent images, and after some technical difficulties, both teams managed it. Here's one of the images from Brazil. The results of this experiment confirmed that prediction from general relativity. Light is, in fact, affected by gravity, just like squirrels. As far as we can tell, gravity is just acceleration we can't see. The equivalence principle might not apply to solar eclipses, but it did present us with a thought experiment, which led us to conduct a real one, a real experiment we never would have thought to do otherwise. So is the equivalence principle true? Yes. Is it universal? No. But that doesn't mean it hasn't been extremely useful. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Let's talk about Nebula, a different kind of streaming service. Different because it's owned and run by us, the creators on the platform. Tons of creators like me put our regular content there completely ad and sponsor free. There's also a long list of exclusive content you won't find anywhere else on the internet. Want to watch a feature-length analysis on how they adapted Lord of the Rings into the best trilogy ever made? There's a Nebula original from Lindsay Ellis. Want to see a multi-part series exploring the history of human evolution? Check out Becoming Human by Real Science. They even have Nebula classes like What is Code by Coding Train, where you can begin to learn a skill that's becoming more necessary as time goes on. I know, you're probably thinking that you don't want another streaming service. I get that. And frankly, I'm a bit biased because I'm on said platform. But I feel like it's great because it's what I actually watch, and they're not charging an arm and a leg either. Using my link to sign up will get you 40% off the annual plan. But also, Nebula is currently offering lifetime memberships for a limited time. You pay once and get access for your entire life. It's kind of revolutionary, but if you're interested in any of the streaming plans, sign up using our link. It really helps out the channel. Many of you pointed out that we needed the distance to the sun to use stellar parallax. And that's true. Thankfully, we found that 166 years before we used parallax on other stars. But that's a topic for another day. Anyway, thanks for watching!